Okay, welcome to today's lesson. Today we're doing quantity. I'm going to do a lot more vocabulary lessons in the next few weeks because I want to push my students through a lot more vocabulary. And so we're dealing with quantity today, which I hope won't be too difficult. The first thing to take into account is that we can say a number of with countable nouns and an amount of with uncountable nouns. That's what the C means and the U means. Use this for countable nouns like apples, pears, sofas, carpets, and use amount of with uncountable nouns like work or time or money. And you can say also whether it's a small amount of money or a large amount of money. You could use this one or this one to modify the amount, to change the amount. And you've got all of these adjectives here. All of these mean tiny. You can say a tiny number of, a minuscule amount of, a minute number of. Minute means very small. Here it looks like minute because it's the same spelling, but if you change the pronunciation and say minute, it means very, very tiny. And a negligible amount of. Negligible means so small it's not worth considering. So small that it's unimportant, it's trivial. You don't need to take it into account. So you could use all of these to modify number or amount, but if you want to make it a bit bigger, and that's the scale here, we're getting bigger as we go this way, you could say a small number of, an insignificant number of, a meagre number of, a paltry number of, an underwhelming number of, and all of those would mean not many or not much, depending on if we're doing countable, many, or uncountable, much. And please remember that we use few with countable and little with uncountable as well. They're certainly worth remembering as well for countable and uncountable. Or we could say an average number of, a standard number of, a typical amount of, or an ordinary amount of. We could get bigger and say a large amount of, a considerable amount of, a sizable number of, a reasonable number of. Or we could get massive and say a massive number of, a vast number of, a huge amount of, an overwhelming amount of. And if you use these expressions, they will add more flavour to your writing, so that you're speaking, so that you can use a vast number of words. And if you have a large amount of vocabulary, it really will, people will notice, and it really helps the quality of your speech and of your writing as well. Now, if you want to use some mathematical terms, if you want to know how to say this, we say to multiply or times. Yeah, you can say 5 times 5 equals 25. You ought to say equals or is, but equals is that. And we use the preposition by for multiply and divide. Yeah, 5 multiplied by 3 equals, like that. And the same with divide. 10 divided by 5 equals. Okay, and when we divide, sometimes it doesn't divide into a whole number. For example, if you have a number like 45 and you say 45 divided by 7, you need to say 45 divided by 7 equals 6, remainder 3. There's 3 left over. Left over also kind of means to remain, left over. So there's a remainder of 3, there's 3 left over. You can also add or plus if you're talking about this one, or subtract or minus if you're talking about this one. And there's 2 phrasal verbs here. To add up is plus and to take away is minus. So they may also be quite useful. If you want to say that something has been increased by a factor of 2, and notice I've got that expression, by a factor of 2, that means it doubles. Yeah, something doubles when it increases by a factor of 2. If something increases by a factor of 3, it triples. If something increases by a factor of 4, it quadruples. So we do have verbs for 2, 3, and 4. For 5 or 6 or 10, you just have to say there has been a 5-fold increase, I don't know, in the number of people going to their GPs and asking for treatment, something like that. But it could be a 10-fold increase, a 20-fold increase. We could say that also to to describe that increase. Now, if there's a relationship between two factors or between two numbers, you can say there is a correlation between those two factors or those two numbers, or there's a correlation between the x-axis, so it's down there, the x-axis and the y-axis, meaning there's some kind of relationship between what's on the x-axis and what's on the y-axis. And I ought to do this next, really, because this is a correlation. You can say that something is inversely proportional to something else. This means that while x increases, y decreases. When things are inversely proportional, one increases as the other one decreases. But if something is directly proportional to something else, then when one increases, the other one increases as well. So this is to describe different types of relationship, different types of correlation between two different numbers. And if something isn't right with the numbers, if something seems illogical or one number doesn't fit in with the rest of the graph, you can say that that number is a discrepancy, an anomaly. And that just means something which perhaps was unexpected or doesn't fit in to the rest of the pattern. It doesn't fit in to the rest of the logic of the graph. Now, this may be because there is an error or a flaw with that number. So it's worth remembering these words to describe whenever there's a number which seems out of place. And that number which is out of place is a discrepancy, an anomaly. If we're dealing with numbers, you might want to say that somebody made a precise guess or a precise calculation, maybe. If they have figured it out, if they have worked it out, and they're two good phrasal verbs for numbers, meaning to calculate, then they may have given you a precise calculation, an exact calculation, but they might not have done. They might have just given you a rough estimate, which means a guess, a rough estimate. Whenever something is done roughly, roughly means approximately. Roughly is informal and approximately is more formal, but they're also very useful number words, roughly, approximately. So a rough estimate is an approximate estimate. It's also known as a ballpark figure in idiomatic English. Okay, there are a couple more phrasal verbs. To round up or round down, you do this when you're quite young at school. You might round the number 58 up to 60 to make things easier. And you might round 10.0154. You might round that decimal down to 10 to make it a nice round number. We even say a nice round number, meaning a whole number would be another way of saying that. A whole number like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Decimals are usually used to describe things which are not whole numbers. Okay, so a whole number would be a complete number. A decimal would be something like 0.5 or 0.25. And it can be greater than one as well. It could be 10.0125, and that would still be a decimal. So again, when you're young and at school, you do a lot of work with decimals, and you do a lot of work with fractions. This one's called a half, this one's called a quarter, and then they get quite easy. You just add th on the end, so an eighth, a sixteenth. And if you've got a higher number up here, it would be two quarters, or 3/8 or 7/16, whatever it is at the top, you just say the fraction like that. So we have fractions and we have decimals too. And we also have percentages. And with percentage, you can use these words as well. You can say a minuscule percentage of, a considerable percentage of, an overwhelming percentage of. All of that would make sense too. Now, we can use the expressions dozens of or tons of with countable nouns. By the way, a dozen is actually 12. So when we say dozens of, we just mean loads of. You could even say hundreds of here, or thousands of, and it really ought to be countable because you can see that it's a number, and so it's better for countable nouns. Hundreds of, dozens of, thousands of, tons of, millions of as well. And then we do add the S, by the way, even though we say 6 million without the S. When we say millions of, then we do use an S because it's not definite, the number. It's an indefinite number. Okay, use plenty of, heaps of, loads of, or lots of for countable and uncountable nouns. You can use a good deal of or a great deal of for uncountable. That one's quite formal. Very good one to use in your written essays. And you can say a drop of for uncountable liquids, usually. Yeah, a drop of water, a drop of wine, something like that. Lastly, we've got a lot of nouns here where we quantify a group of or an amount of or a number of things. So we can say a pile of papers, and we often use this word pile, meaning when things are stacked on top of each other. And so very similar to stack here, but I would only say stack if they're literally stacked on top of each other, like a stack of chairs. But we can say a pile of papers. You could even say a heap of papers there as well. Nothing wrong with that. A heap of papers, a pile of papers, a slice of cake. I think everyone knows that one. A slice of bread, a slice of cake, a packet of crisps. I'm sure you all know it. A flock of seagulls, a swarm of bees, a pack of dogs, a herd of cows. So we have different collective nouns here for the animals. I think every animal has its own collective noun. I don't know all of them. If that interests you, please look it up online. You'll find that every single animal has a different kind of word that you can use with it. And so that can be really quite, well, it can certainly boost your vocabulary. It can certainly give you a vast number of words if you learn all of those. I'm afraid I don't know many of them. A row of seats, you can say. Yeah, row is a very useful word for a row of seats, meaning a line of seats. A gust of wind, meaning a small, a bit of wind which quickly comes across you, a gust of wind. A lock of hair, meaning a small, it's not really a strand of hair. I'd say a strand of hair for one, but a lock of hair, I think of quite a few hairs in a lock of hair, but one piece of the hair. An item of clothing or an article of clothing, it's another way you can say it. A stroke of luck, a lump of sugar, a puff of smoke, a bunch of flowers, a crowd of people, a stack of chairs, a set of tools. Remember, we use this word set for when you have the complete set of something. So normally we say a set of tools, meaning a hammer, a spanner, a chisel, a saw, all the different tools all put together in one box. And a fit of rage, a fit of anger. This means like a burst of rage, a burst of anger. You can even say a fit of laughter. So we often use a fit of plus these emotions to quantify emotion. Okay, that's all I've got for you today. If you have any questions about this vocabulary, please put them under the video, and I hope to see you all soon.